Greetings, everyone. This is Michael, and welcome back to another Stuart Gordon movie review. Well, guys, today's film was actually suggested to me by a user here on YouTube. He said that he watched the film and that he enjoyed it, thought it was a pretty good damn movie. Well, I saw the film on Sunday, about 3 days ago, and originally I was going to review it straight away, but I couldn't quite find the words to sum up the movie. And also, guys, I was concerned with how I was going to describe the plot because I didn't want to give too much of the film away. And that is always my intention, my goal, but sometimes I fail miserably at it. But anyway, the movie is King of the Ants. No relations. But anyway, guys, despite this cover here, it is not a horror film. I would classify it as a psychological thriller or maybe a crime drama. But here's the back of it, guys. King of the Ants. Now, guys, this movie is actually based upon a book of the same name. And as a matter of fact, the screenplay was written by the author that actually wrote the book. And a little bit of history on this film, guys. Many of you will know, George Wendt. Now, he played the heavyset guy on Cheers. And unfortunately, guys, I never watched Cheers. It just wasn't my type of show. I know it's a really much loved show, but I never watched Cheers. He was a big fan of the book and actually optioned the book, had the rights to make the book into a film. And he took it around, couldn't get anybody interested in it. And finally, he discovered Stuart Gordon. And Stuart Gordon read the book at his suggestion. Loved the book, absolutely loved it, couldn't put the book down. And George Wendt was like, hey, if you want to make this into a movie, I can get that going. And Stuart Gordon agreed, and they got the screenplay from the author of the book, and they shopped it around to several studios, but no studio was interested in making this film. And as a matter of fact, some of the studios even said they loved the screenplay, thought it was really, really good, but they didn't see this film as being marketable because of the subject matter, because of the fact that it's a very downbeat film, it's a violent film, there's no real hero character in the film. So studios passed on it. Now, what's surprising, guys, and what I learned about this movie while reading up on it is the fact that the studio that they actually got to finally make the film is the Asylum. Now, you guys know this studio. I mean, this is the same studio that makes Giant Shark versus Mega Pussy and all these weird old low budget films and these mockumentary films, Transmorphers, all these really cheap low budget films. The Asylum. They are the ones, the only ones that would back Stuart Gordon in making this movie. So they did back him and the movie got made. And despite the fact that when the film was released, it did receive a lot of critical praise. A lot of people liked the movie. But at the same time, a lot of people, I would say more liked it than didn't like it. Kind of like a 60-40 kind of thing. And King of the Ants, guys, let me go into the story a little bit. Now, let's get some information on this, guys. Chris McKenna. That's him in that picture there, guys. No, I'm kidding. Chris McKenna plays a guy named Sean who's an odd job kind of guy going from job to job to make a living. No specific function in life. He doesn't have a specific job or he doesn't have a specific skill. He's just a drifting from job to job and doing whatever he can do to make it, to pay the bills. So one day he's painting this house for someone, and he gets a knock at the door of the house, and he says, hey, who are you? And the guy says, I'm the electrician. Now, the electrician is played by George Wendt, who plays Duke in the film. And, you know, Duke gets to talking to him, kind of discovers that Sean is just a job jumper going from here to there, and he goes, hey, my boss may have some work for you in the future, So if you're interested, give me your phone number and I'll call you. So they exchange numbers, and Duke ends up calling Sean pretty immediately. At least I think his name was Sean in the film. Yeah, Sean. And so he takes Sean to see his boss, who's played by Daniel Baldwin. And more or less, Daniel Baldwin says, hey, I need you to do a job for me. I want you to follow this guy. You know, I want everywhere he goes, I want you to follow him. If he goes to the bathroom and pisses, I want to know what color it is and all this kind of stuff. So Sean agrees to follow the guy, despite the fact that, you know, he gets to the guy's house, kind of spies on him a little. And the guy has a car and Sean has a bike. But still yet, Sean's able to keep up with this guy and follow him everywhere he goes. Which is basically just the work. And then, you know, the guy takes a subway, and Sean's on the subway with him and all this. But, you know, during the course of spying on this guy, Sean happens to see the guy's wife. And he kind of falls for the guy's wife. He does fall for the wife. He thinks she's attractive, wants to be with her. Kind of a magnetic kind of thing. Love at first sight kind of thing, if you will. So he is infatuated deeply with the wife. And to the point of visualizing her sexually and just really feeling a strong attraction to this woman. So anyway, after spying on the guy one day, he heads back home, and Daniel Baldwin's out in front of his house in a car. And Sean gets in the car with him, and Baldwin takes it a step forward, and he says, hey, I need you to do something else for me. This guy, I need you to kill him. And, you know, Sean is a little surprised. He doesn't act real surprised, but Baldwin says, what will it take for you to kill this guy? And he goes, well, there'll have to be certain assurances. You know, I'll have to, there'll have to be several points we need to cover, 3 points. You know, it'll have to be done where it can't be traced back to me. And I'll have to have suitable weapons, you know, so that this can't turn on me and I could get killed. And, you know, and all these excuses. And then finally, you know, he gets around the money. And then, you know, they agree upon $13,000. That's what it'll take to kill the guy. And kind of a funny scene. Sean is just kind of going back and forth in and out like he can't believe it. And the guy's asked him to do this. And he's like, what number was I on? And Daniel Baldwin says something like, I don't give a fuck. What the fuck? I don't care. You lost me at 3. But it was a pretty good scene, guys. And so Sean agrees to kill the guy for 13 grand. And see, guys, here I am now at a dilemma, because I don't want to go too far into the story. Because if I tell you, you know, like, for instance, if he did it, if he didn't do it, what happens after that and this and that, I don't want to tell you all that stuff. But because I don't want to ruin the story for you. But so I think I'll stop there, guys. So, you know, in recapping, Sean is hired to kill this guy for $13,000. And a little bit on Daniel Baldwin's character, he's a shady land developer, so he's not that all that great of a guy either. And Duke is not what he seems to be. And I could go further into this, guys, but I just don't want to ruin it for you. But in ending that, what I will say, that basically this story, to me, King of the Ants, what does that mean? You know, there's even a scene in the film where Duke is, you know, holding Sean by the neck, and he's trying to, they're at the zoo, and he's saying, you know, people come to the zoo because they want to know what kind of animal they look like. What kind of animal are you, Sean? What kind of animal are you? And he goes, oh, I found you. There you are. You're an ant. You're scurrying around. You're an insect. So I think the metaphor of the ants, King of the Ants, as far as the book and the movie is concerned, is that people are insects. They're scurrying around. You know, life goes on. You know, we're bound to do or don't. Life goes on. We die. We keep going. So I think that's the metaphor of the film. It's not really all too clear, and someone may disagree with me, but the film uses quite a bit of metaphors in letting the viewer kind of decide what's going on it don't really answer too many questions about what's going on as far as... It's... The movie itself, guys, and I could go further into the plot, but I'm not going to do it, but... Sean, who's at the beginning of this film, seems like your typical normal guy. He's not really out to hurt anybody. He's not really out to cheat anybody. But by the end of the movie, he's transformed into a different kind of character, a different kind of guy. He don't care. The consequences for what he done don't seem to bother him. And... I didn't hate the movie, but at the same time, you know, it's difficult to enjoy a film or like a film if you don't really care for the characters. Now, at the beginning of the film, I thought Sean was a pretty okay guy, but by the end of the movie, you're thinking, you know, whatever happens to this guy, he deserves it. This is not a film that you're going to sit there and watch and root for the bad guys or the good guys or invest in a hero. Because there's no real hero in this movie. And it's more like when you watch this movie, you're just watching a character study. You're watching the experiences of a human being. You're watching events, a series of unfortunate events that happened to a character in this movie, and you see this character change. So you're really just watching the tale of someone being affected by outside forces. It's an experiment. You're seeing how life affects somebody, how life molds somebody, how life changes somebody. And even if it doesn't change somebody for the good, it's still something that you're watching, seeing done, and you're there, but you're not really with the character. I mean, you're not taking any emotional investment in this character because, you know, basically, you don't like the way he turns out. But anyway, guys, and I probably gave away too much there, but this is a character study. This is character-driven. You watch Sean's life spiral out of control. It's one of those films where he... should have looked before he leaped. He got in too deep, did something he wasn't supposed to do, and now he has to bear the consequences for it, and justly so, because he did commit the crime. And, like I said, guys, the film is full of metaphors. I mean, you have a scene in the film where Sean is tied up, and he's being beaten, and after each beating, he's seeing these images, and he's going in and out, and these images just get weirder and weirder. And by the time the last image rolls around, he's looking at Jabba the Hutt eating her own shit. But anyway, you know, you'll sit there and you'll watch this and you'll think, what the fuck does this mean? What is the deal? And if you've seen the movie, my only experience from that scene is thinking that that's his guilt. His guilt for what he's done is getting bigger and bigger and bigger, more extreme. And... what I thought was kind of interesting, an interesting kind of event in the film is, you know, the more they beat this guy, he comes to a point where it's like a narcotic to him. It's like a drug, you know. It's where, you know, somebody's going to beat you up and beat you up and beat you up. And then you get to the point where, you know, hey, here are the deals to beat me up. Here you go. Yeah, let's get this done. Where you're expecting it. So it's not a big deal anymore. So Sean definitely changes. And I think a fault of the film is the fact that, despite the fact that what he goes through, the film is, it's just a little bit too vague as explaining what's going on. I mean, it's like the film couldn't quite clearly represent what it was trying to say. I mean, sure, you know, is it saying that environment breeds... contempt, environment breeds behavior. I mean, it's kind of muddled over and just really not well focused on. And then what's really, really kind of confusing about the movie, guys, is that, you know, if the filmmaker's intent was to show us that, okay, we're going to take this nice guy here, we're going to show some outside forces, and we're going to show how extreme someone's life can turn around, when they're down on their luck and these bad events happen. Fine. Let's do that. But, you know, when you have a character that you say, hey, I want you to kill somebody, and they agree to kill them before any of these things ever happened, you're sitting there thinking, well, was he a killer all along? I mean, you know, it didn't take the rest of the film to change him completely, because he was willing to do it before any of these bad things ever happened to him. So that's what I mean by the film is kind of, it's not really quite sure what direction it wants to go in, because, I mean, you didn't take a mild-mannered guy here that, you know, oh, I wouldn't do that, no way at all. You have a guy that agreed to do it before anything bad ever happened to him. So, I don't know, guys, you know, and listening to the commentary by Stuart Gordon, I was really, really eager to listen to it just to see how he interpreted this movie. And he doesn't really give a clear vision of what this film was going for. You hear vague things about, oh yeah, this happened to him, so you know, he by this time he wants revenge. And but you never really hear any basic fundamental footing on what this film was really trying to do. So while I think it's not a bad film by far, I think it's just a film that kind of loses its direction. Definitely not one of Stuart Gordon's best films, but I think it's a film that, you know, with just a little bit more focus, a little better cinematography. They're definitely using 35mm handheld cameras in this, and every scene, it's like they used a handy cam with this, and the scene never, the movie never settles down. It's always moving. And it just gives the film kind of an amateuristic feel to it. And that's not to say that the film don't look good, because it does look pretty good, guys. I like the look of the film. But unfortunately, I just think the film, if it had a clear direction on what it was trying to do, I think that it would have been a much more entertaining film. And then, logistically, a lot of things in the film just did not make any logical sense. And now, of course, I can't tell you those things, guys, because I don't want to delve too deeply into the plot. But a lot of the film just logically did not make any sense. I mean, you have Daniel Baldwin's character here. He's a shady land construction guy, and he's got two guys working for him. That's all you ever see, two guys working for him. And these guys are shady enough, you know, to the things they assist him in doing in the movie. You know, you just think, my God, is it that easy to do this kind of stuff? But just the events in the final act of the film. Now, this Stuart Gordon said this film actually had four acts in the commentary. But if we go by the third act, the first part of the film, the setup, the build-up, is really kind of unique. But when we get into the second, third, and final act, it falls apart because logistically, you're thinking, no, that would not happen. No. But if you ever watch the film, you'll see what I mean. And I would definitely love to hear you guys' opinion on this movie just to see what you think about it. But King of the Ants is a film that touches on brilliance. And I can see that it had a lot of potential. This had the potential to be a really, really good film. But like I said, unfortunately, it seems to have lost its way. Especially logistically, as far as what the screenplay does. It's just things that happen in the film that you just can't see someone doing. I mean, there's just one gun in this movie at the end of the film where you're thinking, you know, get a gun. A gun would really help here. Get a gun. I mean, you'll see what I mean when you watch the movie. And I'm definitely recommending that you watch the film, guys. Just I want to hear what you guys think, so please leave your comments. I also got to say, guys, that we have... what is her name? There's a female in this, Carrie Wuerer. And I hope I pronounced her last name right. Carrie Wuerer. And she's a beautiful actress, girl next door actress, who plays the love interest of Sean in the film. And there is some nudity in the film. She gets nude in the film, and quite a few times you see her breasts. And, you know, guys, it's really, really nice how natural and how beautiful a woman's breasts are when they're just natural and not siliconed, you know. I just thought I'd throw that in. But she's in the film, does a really good job in the film. actions around her character are really questionable. I mean, really questionable. The things she does, the things she's allowing. You're just thinking, in today's age, no, you don't do that. No. But definitely, guys, check out King of the Ants. Decent film. Probably one of Stuart Gordon's most ambitious films. I'm sure that, you know, this is not going to be a movie that when Stuart Gordon is put out to pasture, that this is not going to be the film that you remember him by. But it's definitely a movie that deserves to be watched. And it does kind of, you know, allow you to speculate on things and all that. But I would say give it a look, guys. And this film also has, and I can't think of his name. What is his name? Let me go on. This is just a little tidbit of information here that you guys might find interesting. But the film co-stars the actor that played Bennett in Commando. And, you know, you action guys are already saying, oh, that's, and I don't know the guy's name. I'm not too, oh, Vernon Wells. Wasn't it Bennett in Commando? I haven't seen Commando in years. I believe it was Vernon Wells in Commando. Let's see. Yeah, he played the main bad guy that Arnold Schwarzenegger fought against in Commando, Bennett. In the film, he's called Beckett. And he's in the movie, and, you know, he's does a decent job in the film. Likeable character. But anyway, guys, thanks for watching. King of the Ants, definitely check it out when you get the chance. Let me know what you think. Take care, guys, and I'll see you at the next Stuart Gordon movie discussion. Thanks for watching.